Okay, yeah, we're gonna need words. I guess we have a with the boys tonight. We caught her off guard. You know these words anyway. She's traveling this weekend. Her daughter, their one and only daughter, the light of their life, got married this weekend. So she and Emily and Cody, and they always thought it would be neat to get married on 10-10 and 2020. And so that's what they did. So if Cody ever forgets his anniversary, he's in trouble. I'm just saying, you got one that easy, you better remember it. So they're traveling this weekend. They went out to Colorado where they have family as well, and they got married out in Colorado. So I'm sure it was a beautiful wedding. We're going to continue this morning. Thanks for being here. Thanks for coming to worship with us.
Name that matters to me.
name that we love to sing about, a name that we look forward to someday being able to sing over and over. The one who came to earth, that died so that we might live. We thank you, Lord, for that beautiful name. We ask now that you would speak through Danny as he tells us about Jesus. These things we pray in your name. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm so glad that you're here. I'm excited that you're with us this morning. We're looking forward to what God's going to give us today in his word as we continue on with the miracles of Jesus. Today we're going to be talking about the big fish story. So what I want to do is I want to set it up. How many people in here like to fish? Raise your hand. Oh, we have many, many fishermen, whether they're men or women. It doesn't make any difference. We've got a lot of fishermen. Now, it involves a lot of things. Sometimes when you go fishing, you have to bait your own hook, and sometimes the ladies doesn't always like to do that, and their man will put the bait on, and then they'll fish, and then they catch the fish, and then they'll ask their man to take the fish off the hook. Now, that's not really fishing. You know, it's more work for the guy. But there are some ladies that say, you know what, that worm or that cricket or that minnow doesn't bother me that much, and I'll do it myself. And they'll bait their own hook, and they'll catch their own fish, and they'll take it off the hook, and they'll even fillet it themselves. Wow, now that's a woman that you want to keep, right? Right there, that's a woman that you want to have at your house. But we're going to be talking about a big fish story. We're going to be talking about how you got to know where it's at. So I'll tell you a story that happened, true story that happened to me when I was a kid growing up. There was this guy that lived up the road from us when we lived in Tennessee. And his first name was Hal, and he was a really good fisherman. And so me and my dad was in this old pickup truck. It was his dad's truck, so it was really old. It was like 68 Ford. And we drove up the road, and we got to this guy's house. And my dad wanted to know from Hal how the fish was before he put his boat out to go fishing. If the fish are biting, we're going to go fishing. If the fish ain't biting, then we're not. And this guy will know. So he honks the horn, and Hal had two deep freezers on his carport full of fish. He had another two or three deep freezers in his house full of fish. This guy knew how to fish. He knew where the fish was at. That's the secret. Knowing where they're at. Knowing what they're biting on. This guy knew. So he comes out to the truck. He walks up. My dad says to him, he says, well, how's the fish today? He says, oh, he says, I didn't do that good. He said, they're not really biting today. He said, I only caught 100. And I sat in the truck and I thought about what he said. And I thought to myself, if me and my dad would ever catch 100 fish, I think I would dance on the dock and run all the way back home to tell Mom we actually caught 100 fish. But this guy said it wasn't a good day because he only caught around 100 fish. I'm thinking, man, what in the world is this guy thinking? Now, you think of that, about that, and you think about knowing where the fish is. Peter knew where the fish was. What Peter's job was that he was a commercial fisherman. He didn't own just one boat, but he had two boats at least. And he knew exactly where the fish was. He knew exactly where to let down his nets. And he had been out there all night long. So now he's tired. He's hungry. He wants to go home and sleep all day because he worked the midnight shift, right, doing fish. And they didn't catch nothing. And they get on the shore cleaning all the nets. Now the nets are all clean and they're all back in the boat. So I want you to get this in your mind. You got to know where the fish is. You got to know how to catch the fish. You got to use the right bait, right? Yep. And then you'll catch it. So this is where we're going to start with today. So I want you to think about this big fish story as we look at our scripture today. Look at Luke chapter 5. Luke chapter 5. It says, one day Jesus was preaching on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. Great crowds pressed in on him to listen to the word of God. He noticed two empty boats at the water's edge, for the fishermen had left them and were washing their nets. Stepping into one of the boats, Jesus asked Simon, its owner, to push it out into the water. So he sat in the boat and taught the crowds from there. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, now go out where it is deeper. Now let's pause here. Peter is a commercial, I want to reiterate, he's a commercial fisherman. Been doing it for a long time. He knows exactly in this place where the fish is. Jesus is now telling who? He's laying eyes on Jesus. He's heard of him. He's heard of Jesus. But now he's laying eyes on Jesus. And this guy that he honestly really doesn't know all that well, let's say, is telling him to go out in the deep water, a commercial fisherman. I'm going to tell you how to fish. I'm going to take you out. You take your boat. You listen to me. I've never been on this water before, but you listen to me and I'm going to catch you some fish. What do you think Peter's thinking? He's thinking, yeah, right. Okay, now we pick it up from here. All right. Look at verse 4 again. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, now go out where it is deeper. Let down your nets to catch some fish. Then this is what Peter says, verse 5. Master Simon replied, we worked hard all night and didn't catch a thing. So he's trying to tell him, ain't going to work. I know this lake. I know where we're at. I know how to catch fish. And you're going to try to teach me how to catch fish. I'm telling you, Lord, this ain't going to work. But if you say so, Peter says, I'll let the nets down again. And this time, their nets were so full of fish, they began to tear. A shout for help brought their partners in the other boat, and soon both boats were filled with fish on the verge of sinking. When Simon Peter realized what had happened, he fell to his knees before Jesus and said, oh Lord, please leave me. I am such a sinful man. For he was awestruck by the number of fish they had caught, as were the others with him. His partner James and John, the sons of Zebedee, were also amazed. Jesus replied to Simon, do not be afraid. From now on, you will be fishing for people. And as soon as they landed, they left everything and followed Jesus. Wow, what a fish story, huh? Yeah. So this guy that supposedly knows all about fishing, he's a commercial fisherman, has now got somebody named Jesus, some teacher named Jesus, some miracle worker named Jesus. That's all we know about him, right? Word travels fast. He's telling me how to fish. And he says, I've been out here all stinking night. I am wet, I am tired, I am hungry, and I'd like to go home and go to bed. Do you think that's what he's thinking?
No.
Probably what he's thinking. But he says, if you say so, we'll go out in the deep where there is no fish. Think about what Peter's thinking. We'll go out in the deep probably where there is no fish because I've been out all over this lake. There ain't none out there. We've been out there all night. But he says, if you say so, we'll go. So the first thing we want to see is that obedience demands action. Obedience demands action. Never let mere listening be a substitute for action. Don't just listen to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Put it in action. Peter had heard the message of Jesus. He was a captive audience because he was in the boat. Remember when Jesus said in our scripture, he said, hey, take me out a little ways. I'm going to preach to these people. What happened was the people came down and they were on the shore and they were pressing in so much that Jesus was standing in the water. And he says, I got to get on a place where I can get past these people a little bit so I can speak to them and tell them the gospel. So he said, hey, Peter, will you push your boat out a little ways in the water and I'll preach off of it. So he used his boat as a pulpit, right? Okay? So Peter's sitting in the boat with Jesus and Jesus is teaching the crowd on the shore and he's a captive audience. He's listening to everything Jesus said. But Jesus desired for him to do more than just listen for Peter. He wanted him to act. Now listen to this story. How many of you remember the story of a tightrope walker who was rolling a wheelbarrow back and forth across Niagara Falls? Thousands of people were shouting him on, you can do it, you can do it. He put 200-pound sacks of dirt in the wheelbarrow and rolled it back and forth, over and over he rolled it. Then he turned to the crowd and said, how many of you believe that I can roll a man across this rope? Everybody shouted. One man in the front row was so excited, he professed his belief. I believe you can, sir. The tightrope walker pointed at him, excited person, and he says, well, then you're next. He couldn't see for the dust from the man running away so fast. See, he didn't believe it. He said he believed it. He thought he believed it, but he was not willing to get in the wheelbarrow. A lot of times that's what we are. Now listen again. He didn't believe it. That's one. Two, he said he believed it. That could be somebody. And three, thought he believed it. That's all three categories about the gospel when people hear it. They don't believe it at all, right? They heard what he said, right? Or they thought they really accepted it, right? So Peter sat in the boat with Jesus. He listened to his words. He believed on him. But now it was time to act. Now, contrary to the tightrope walker, Peter obeyed. Obedience is faith in action, ladies and gentlemen. Faith in action. It is transposing the promise and provisions of Christ's words into service and obedient behavior. Have you ever noticed that in the New Testament, Jesus never said to his hearers, just believe on me? He always used the urge them to follow me. He never said believe on me, he said follow me, didn't he? In other words, his commands to his hearers was to get in the wheelbarrow and let me push you across Niagara Falls. That's what we're supposed to do. In other words, Jesus says, I can take you across the falls, you get in the wheelbarrow. We're looking down in the water, and we're seeing the falls, we're seeing how far it is, and we're saying to ourselves, do I believe this guy? Do I really trust this guy? Is this guy really going to protect me? Can I get to the other side? Am I willing to get in that wheelbarrow? See, don't just say you believe in Jesus. Don't just say that you know Jesus. Don't just say that I love Jesus. Get in the wheelbarrow and follow Jesus. Peter said, what I believe, I do, and the rest is just religious talk. Peter Lord said, what I believe, I do, and the rest is just religious talk. Isn't that true? What I believe, I do. If I believe that things are important to Christ, they're important to me, and I'll do them. If I don't believe that they're important to Christ, well, then I don't do them at all, right? So it's how you believe. Second thing is obedience calls for the moving out of our comfort zones. Obedience calls us to move out of our comfort zones. Peter was comfortable fishing at night along the shoreline. But to launch out into the deep during the day, that's a whole nother story, isn't it? Most people live in the shallow waters of life. They never get out in the deep. They simply exist on a superficial level. And that's true. Only on the surface. They only want to know about a little bit about the Bible stories. You ever know that? You tell somebody, says, well, you know about Noah and the flood? Yeah, it was a boat. All the animals got in, two by two. Floods came and receded, and everybody's here today because of that. That's all superficial. You got to get into the Word of God to find out what was behind all that. So they know the story, but they don't go deeper into the story. See, there's little depth to their lives because they're content to just play around the edge of the water, never going into the deeper water. And that's true. And in church, that happens. Instead of getting deep into God's word, we're happy and content to play around the edge of the water, right? Go out and get in about waist high and say, that's good enough. I don't need to go any further. Go in about ankle deep and you say, well, now I'm cooled off enough. I don't have to worry about it anymore, right? And that's what people do with the gospel. They only play around the edge of the water. Why? Because it's safer in shallow water. Safer. That's how they feel, right? So they think if I get into the deep water, there might be some waves that might rock the boat. It might overturn. So I'll just stay back here where it's safe and be comfortable and piddle around in this water that's only about knee high. God calls us to obedience and always involves risk to leave the comfort zone, to step out into the deep. Only those people who are willing to follow Jesus leap into the deep water, right? Where it's over their heads and ever really make a difference are the people who go in the deep water. Those are the people that ever really make a difference. You got to get out there, and sometimes you got to get in over your head. Sometimes you got to dive into that ministry. Sometimes you got to get in the gospel. Sometimes you got to do things you don't like to do, just like catching people. People are like fish. Once you catch them, you got to clean them, right? And when we get people into the gospel, when we hear the people hear the gospel of Jesus Christ, and they come to church, they're not going to act the way you've been acting for the last 10 years because you've been in church. They're going to say things. They're going to do things. They're going to act a certain way. Opposite of the way you act. So what do you got to do? Well, they got to learn. Everybody's got to learn, right? So you got to clean them. That's how it works. You catch the fish, you got to clean the fish. You catch the people, then God's got to clean the people up. You see how it works? So that's what we're doing here. So Jesus says, you know, you got to do this. So everybody that gets in over their head, sometimes it happens where those are the people God can use, right? They're the ones that can make a difference. Obedience means doing things that doesn't make sense. right? What did Peter say? I've been out here all night long. I've been fishing all night long. And now you're telling me to go back out after I clean my nets? Now you want me to get my nets dirty all over again? Do you know how long it took me to clean those nets? This is all going through his head. It wouldn't be mine. Wouldn't it yours? And Jesus is saying, come on, Peter, let's go out. Go out in the deep water, right? Obedience means doing things that don't make sense. See, there was nothing logical about returning to the open sea and fishing again for Peter. To Peter, it was absurd. This is ridiculous. But Jesus says, go. And Peter said, because you say so, I will let down my nets in verse 5. Why can we take Jesus at his word and do what he asks simply because he says so? Why can't we? That's a good question. Why can't we just take Jesus at his word? Why can't we just accept it and do it? Because Jesus' perspective is greater than our perspective. I only see just so far. Jesus can see farther. God grants us a limited perspective. What I see is what I see right here, right now. I see you all. I see you all sitting here. I see us having church. What happens in the next hour from now? I do not know. I have a limited perspective. All I have is what's in front of me. Peter had the same thing. Like the headlights that reach on a car driven at night, you can only see ahead, but only for a short way. That's why they put high beams on a car, so you can see a little bit further. You can see ahead, but only for a short way, whereas God sees the whole road, where we've been, where we are now, and where we are going. Isn't that how God sees? His perspective is bigger. I can obey him because he sees all and knows all. Yes, I want to follow a God that I know that sees all and knows all, right? The most powerful test of obedience is to do those things that don't make sense simply because Jesus says so. Have you ever done something that absolutely doesn't make any sense, but Jesus told you to do it anyway? Man, I tell you what, in the ministry, the 28 years I've been doing it, there's been a lot of stuff that I've done that just absolutely didn't make sense. And I'm serious. Even the math don't add up. You know what I'm saying? If you just go by math don't add up. And it's like, but God wants you to do it. And then somehow, some way, God works it out. And you're sitting there looking back on it, and you're thinking, wow, I cannot believe that that worked. But see, God was in it, and that's the reason why it worked. It happens that way. Obedience leads to opportunity. Obedience will lead to an opportunity. The fact is, Peter had obeyed Jesus. He put his faith into action. He obeyed him when Jesus asked to use the boat for a pulpit. He obeyed him when Jesus asked him to launch out into the deep. Now he was in a position for greater usefulness and a difference making by obeying Jesus to catch men for Christ. He said, you're no longer going to catch fish anymore, Peter, but you're going to catch men from here on out, right? Jesus was calling Peter to a greatest task of all, sharing the good news of Jesus with other people. Many people want to do something big for God, right? We're only going to do something big for God. I had a guy one time tell me, he says, you know, this building's not going to be very big for us. He said, I'm going to be moving here pretty soon, and I'm going to go to a much bigger building. I said, how many people do you plan on having? He says, we're planning on having 1,000 people before long. I said, praise the Lord. I hope you get 1,000 people. I've never seen 1,000 people. I've seen 300, a little over 300, 315. I've seen 315 people. But we've got more people on Facebook, YouTube, and who attends church now than we've had ever before. Church now is running close to 300 people now just because of Facebook and YouTube and all the people that's here. It's incredible how it increased. So we got a pretty good sized church. It's just they're not all sitting here. Right? That's what happens. So this person is going to do something big. They're going to have something like 1,000 people. I hope he does. I hope he succeeds. With everything that's going on today, it's going to be a tall task. Tall task to get people back into church once again. See, Jesus is calling Peter to the greatest task of all, sharing the good news of Jesus with other people. Many people want to do something big for God, just like this guy. They want glamorous and attention-getting jobs, kind of like Joel Osteen. He can't go nowhere without somebody recognizing him, right? John Hagee can't go nowhere without somebody recognizing him, right? Franklin Graham, everybody knows Franklin, right? So these people have the big jobs, and sometimes pastors look at those people and they say, man, I wish I was known like that. I wish I had that big, glamorous, attention-getting type job. But that isn't really where we need to start at. Listen to me. It says the glamorous jobs, but we are unfortunately not obeying God when we are doing the menial, behind-the-scenes jobs. sometimes we don't want to obey God just because it's a meaningful, a small amount of work, not much gratitude, not much praise, nobody says anything, I'm just doing a behind the scenes thing, a menial little bitty job. But God knows you're doing it. God sees you doing it. And God will get the praise for it if you'll just do that job. But sometimes people don't want to do the little jobs. They don't want to start. Until we're obedient in the little things, God can't use us in the big things of life. Sometimes you got to start out at the entry level, cleaning toilets. It's where I started. When I got my job and I was working at the plant, I started cleaning toilets for 7 months. I was a janitor. 7 months cleaning toilets, cleaning showers, cleaning offices, taking out the trash. That's where I was for 7 months. Now, the irony of all that is, my dad was a plant manager. And where was I at? In the toilet. Right? And there I was. I was in the toilet. That's how it works. So I worked my way up from that, ended up getting a better job, bidding on this job, bidding on that job. Pretty soon I had a pretty good size paycheck coming in. Back then it was a good paycheck. And so everything was working out so well. But where did you start? Entry level position. Sometimes, even in ministry, you got to start at an entry level position. You can't just go from a person that got saved and all of a sudden you're Joel Osteen. Yeah. Right? That ain't how it works. You got to start somewhere at the bottom. You got to learn about Jesus. You got to give him the gospel. You got to learn more about him. You got to apply what you read, right? And then you got to move your way up. But sometimes people get upset over the little jobs instead of the big jobs. I want to be seen. I want to be known. But that isn't where it's at. That's not where it's at. The reality is that if we're not willing to make a difference for God where we are, then in all likelihood, we will not make a difference for God wherever we are, right? And that's true. See, a baseball player knows that one has to possess the skills to play in the minor leagues before they can play in the big leagues. You got to work your way up. Single A, double A, triple A, and then the majors. Got to work your way up. You can't just go straight from high school to playing professional baseball. Very, very, very few have ever done it. Just like in basketball, LeBron James went straight from high school. What did he do? Went to the NBA, right? Kobe Bryant went from high school straight to the NBA. How many people really do that? Not very many. Not very many. But they're good, special talent, right? So we have to remember, you gotta work your way up. Any manager knows that an employee must pay the price and perform the job at an entry-level position before they will be promoted to upper level. You got to earn your stripes. Ain't that how it works? And ministry sometimes is no different. Sometimes you got to start at the bottom and work your way up with the Lord. Why? Because during those times, he's teaching you something. Be good in this job, and then I'll give you another one. Be good in that job, then I'll give you another one. It's like stepping stones. God has given us this little job, then the next one's a little bigger, then the next one's bigger than that. And we keep moving up until we can handle the job God wants us to have. But what did he do? He groomed you, he molded you, he shaped you, and he got you prepared for obedience because of that. So we ask this question then, what's keeping you from obeying? What's keeping us from obeying Jesus Christ? I don't know if you noticed, but in the story of Peter, there was one physical feature that was present and never seen. Did you see it? Anybody? Anybody see it? It was the boat. Didn't ever see it. The boats were at the edge of the water's edge. Jesus preached from the boat. The miracle was performed on the boat. Peter's confession was made on the boat. Everything about the boat, right? And the final scene, Peter pulls up the boat on the shore, leaves it behind to follow Jesus. Now think about that. They are full of fish. The scripture says that they were so full that both boats almost sank. Now as a commercial fisherman, don't you think you want to get those fish to market? You know how much money Peter would have had if he would have taken those to market? But what did the scripture say? He said he left it all. Followed Jesus. Left his boat that he owned, left it. Left all the fish in it, left it, and walked away and followed Jesus Christ. Peter knew something bigger was about to happen. And I think the boat is highly significant in the story. The question is why? Why is this significant? Because the boat represents Peter's livelihood, his business, his security, his peace of mind, his future. Peter had made his boat available to Jesus and had used Peter's business as a platform for ministry. That's great, isn't it? It's needed, but too often we tend to separate the secular from the spiritual. Jesus made them come together, kind of like married them together. He's a commercial fisherman. He's got the boat. I got all these people on the shore. I need to get out a little way so I can preach to them. So I'm going to use Peter because I need Peter anyway, because later on, Peter's going to do something big for God. See how it all worked? So he took his commercial side, which is his secular side, and he married it with the spiritual side. He put him in the boat, and now he's stuck in the boat to hear Jesus preach the gospel. He's a captive audience. Where's Peter going to go? He's not going to go anywhere, but he's sitting there listening to Jesus, and he's awestruck by what he says, right? Big difference. So he married the two to get together. We attempt to partition off Christianity from our career. Peter's boat was about keeping him from a life of total and complete obedience. His boat and what it represented was preventing him from living a fully devoted life of obedience. So if he would have said, well, you know, I got all these fish now, I can live comfortably for several weeks, Jesus. I appreciate you taking me out to the deep and showing me all these fish. You be on your way now. I'll see you later. I'm going to go home to the wife and kids. That is not what happened. Peter said, I'm leaving it all, and I'm following you. Why? Because I ain't never seen anybody go out and tell me to go in the deep and pick up some fish in the middle of the day when they're not supposed to be biting. When in this place, there is no fish. And then you turn around and almost tear my nets, and then both boats almost sink. There's something about you, and I'm going to hang around and find out until the end. That's where Peter was at. He left it all to follow Jesus because of obedience. So the question is this, what about you? What about you? If Peter would have held on to his boat and his livelihood and his business, he would have never followed Jesus. What about you? What about your boat? What is your boat? What is your boat? Is it your house? Is it your car? Is it your job? Is it finances? What's your boat? What are you hanging on to and not following Jesus? What's keeping you from a life of usefulness? What's keeping you in a life of doing something big for God? See, a job, a relationship, a bank account, a drive for materialism, a fickle feeling that being fully devoted as a follower of Christ is not exciting enough or would hurt your status. Man, if people found out that I'm totally devoted to Jesus, somebody might talk. Somebody maybe even at my job. What's preventing you from making a difference for eternity's sake? What is it? When it comes to obedience, there should be no middle ground. There's no gray area. You're either with Christ or you're not. Once we have heard the Lord speak, we either act on it or we don't. We either obey or we disobey. What will you decide today? That's the question. How are we going to decide today? Well, in closing, it's hard to swallow, for one to swallow this, right? We think we know all there is to know about freedom. We want to believe that there are liberated people. We learned a long time ago that freedom comes from avoiding the rules, changing the rules, or even breaking the rules. But obedience follows the rules. It violates everything we've been taught in society today. Obedience follows the rules. See, but for the Christian, freedom comes through yielding your will to God and obeying a set of rules. Jesus stated it clearly, if you love me, you will obey what I command in John 14, verse 15. Jesus did not mince words. Obedience to Christ and his words is one of the most distinguishing marks of a Christian. As with Peter, Jesus is not suggesting obedience. He is demanding it. He's not suggesting that you obey him. He's demanding that you obey him. Following Christ involves another kingdom, the kingdom of God. Throughout the Bible, there is written commandments, most notably the Ten Commandments. Notice very clearly that those are commandments, not suggestions. Right? They're the Ten Commandments, not Ten Suggestions, right? Do you want to spend the rest of your life catching fish, or do you want to invest your life in something bigger? That's what Peter had to ask. You want to spend the rest of your life catching fish, Peter? Or how would you like to follow me and do something bigger with your life that will make an impact on eternity forever? What about it, Peter? What do you say? Peter said, I'm leaving all and following you. I ain't never seen anything like that. And I bet you there's more miracles down the road. Boy, was there.
Yeah.
Was there, right? You have only one chance to make your life count. You can make a difference in this broken world. Each and every one of us can. You can tell somebody about Jesus. Peter pulled his boat to shore, still stuffed with the largest catch of fish in his life, and walked away from it to follow Jesus. The question now is this: what will you do? What will you do? Will you walk away from all the stuff that you think is security? Will you say, you know what, I'm willing to give it all up. If it burned up today, that's fine. I still have Jesus. Okay? If you want to change your life and accept Jesus, we invite you to pray a prayer. Would you stand with us? As you pray this, we hope that you'll believe it within your heart, your mind, your soul, and with all your strength. Pray with me. Dear Lord Jesus, I know that I am a sinner, and I ask for your forgiveness. I believe you died for my sins and rose from the dead. I turn from my sins and invite you to come into my heart and life. I want to trust and follow you as my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. You all prayed that prayer and believed it within your heart, your mind, and your soul. The Bible says that you've received Jesus as your Lord and Savior. We ask that you please contact us on Facebook or by our website, toconnectchurch.org, or even call the office at 618-254-1308, and you can talk to us, and we'll be more than happy to share with you more about the gospel of Jesus Christ. We thank you all for being here in person, as well as those that are watching by Facebook and YouTube. We thank you also. Continue to tell somebody, share the gospel, tell them about our channel, and don't forget to check in on Facebook and let everybody know where you've been. Thank you, and God bless you. See you next week.